Gospel of Matthew, last chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28. I will be reading verses 16 through 1. Hear the word of God. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee in the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his holy word. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word this morning, and we pray right now for understanding. We pray that you'd bring your word alive to us in our hearts and in our minds so that we might grasp it. And not only grasp it, but draw it deeply within and try to understand it so that your spirit can take it, use it as a chisel on our characters so that we might become more like you. We ask, Lord, that your spirit would teach us this day. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. From the very beginning, God brought order out of chaos. Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. Now, notice the words used here in this scripture from Genesis to describe the creation process before the hand of God began to order and arrange everything. Three words: formless, empty, and dark. In my mind, I picture this big gob of gluey clay sitting in the darkness in a sculptor's studio on this table. But then the light comes on and the sculptor enters, and with his masterful hands, he takes this clay and he forms it into a work of art. The writer of Genesis discovered this was God's nature. God challenged the chaos before him. God brought the formless, spiraling mass of the universe and formed it into the stars and the planets. And then the marvel of this small planet that we live on, the third rock from the sun, life exploded here by God's hand, by God's order. So God set for us this example of challenging chaos and whatever chaos might be facing us in the lives that we're living. And I'm sure some of you can give examples of chaos that you're facing right now. Might be relationship problems. In your life somewhere, there's a relationship that is just causing you chaos whenever you deal with that relationship. There might be difficulties at work. Something has come up, a challenge, a problem, and it's creating chaos at work. Some of you may have been so busy that you haven't had time to clean your house. You've got a bunch of grandkids living with you, and your house has become chaotic. Sometimes there are unexpected disasters. Things just happen. Unexpected. And they bring chaos into your life. Where there is an irresponsible person somewhere in your life, that person has brought chaos into your life. Chaos enter our lives through many, many avenues. I'm going to share with you an example of chaos in my life that might be unexpected. Sermon writing. Tom can relate to this. I was talking to Tom this morning. He's preparing the next couple sermons for us. You don't want to miss those two sermons, but he knows what I'm talking about. We both go by the lectionary. The lectionary gives us about three Old Testament scriptures for this. this week about three New Testaments, sometimes more, sometimes less. At the beginning of the week, I'll face this chaos. I'll read these scriptures and all these words and images and thoughts and ideas, and they're kind of swirling in front of my eyes like a 2,000-piece puzzle. You sit there and you look at them all, and you think, what in the world am I going to be preaching about? But then I come to the Lord, and I say, Lord, do you need to guide me here? And I begin to pray about these scriptures. Guide me, show me the direction that you want me to go. And then I'll begin to read different commentaries on these passages of scriptures, and more ideas begin coming. And things begin to solidify. And then I'll go back to God, and I'll read over all the notes that I've taken and everything that I've edited down, and I'll pray again. And truths and stories and images begin to reform again, and I get a clearer idea of the direction God wants me to go. And then I get to the point where I can put down an outline of what's been formed out of this chaos of all these possibilities. And then once I get that outline, then I'll sit and begin writing the sermon word by word. And lo and behold, here's another sermon. You know what I've noticed over the years, as I face weekly the chaos of writing a sermon? The most stressful moments come at the beginning. When you start. When you begin reading the scriptures for that week, because you have no idea exactly what direction you're going to go in until God leads you. And it's taking those steps, things begin to become unified. So I learned not to panic. And hopefully, Tom, you've learned not to panic.
Not yet.
I've learned not to panic because I know this is the process that I have to go through. Now, I have to go through these steps. I have to have these feelings to get to the point where a new sermon is born. Now, I believe it's very clear in Scripture that God calls us to challenge the chaos that's confronting us in our lives and in this world. And I look at Psalm 8 as a great example, as instruction from Scripture. The psalmist said this, when I consider your heavens up above, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, or human beings that you care for them? I can picture that psalmist out there under the night sky looking up, and he sees the constellations. They're the same every night. They go through their rotation in the sky, and upon observing that night sky, the psalmist is just convinced of God's power and his ordering of the chaos of the universe, bringing it into order. And then upon considering the magnificence of it all, he asks the question, well, Lord, what do I have to do with this? What's mankind all about? Why did you order and create us? Why did you put us together, the complexity of human life? But then he gives the answer. Verses 5 and 6. He's talking about mankind here. He said, you have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet. And the light comes on in his mind. Out of chaos, God created the universe. He made mankind in God's image. And then he gave us the God-like ability to challenge the chaos before us. In fact, God said it is our responsibility to take on these challenges. We are the stewards of this earth. God calls us to face the messes that are created in front of us. The disarray that might be facing us. The wreckage that happens. God says, take on that challenge, face it. I'm going to help you and empower you to order that chaos that's in front of you. We know that in the secular world, there are scientists and there are physicists, I guess, and other people, inventors, who look at the world and try to solve the world's chaos. They try to solve the world's problem. They come up with technologies and policies and plans, and their goal is to protect and to produce and to provide humankind with a long-term strategy to use Earth's resources effectively so that generations in the future will have a place to live. We know also, though, that there are people who just don't care about the Earth. They may be investors, they may be businessmen, developers, tycoons. They want as much money as they can get out of the Earth's resources as they can get right now, no matter what happens. They're out for money and they're out for today. Profit is the bottom line. Well, that basically tells us that in this world there are chaos creators and chaos challengers. And it goes back to the Garden of Eden. We have the same nature that the first human beings had. We create chaos when we do wrong. But also, we can challenge that chaos through God's power. So the chaos in this world and the problems it creates has its origins there at the beginning of man. As human beings, we have this sin nature. Our selfishness, our sinfulness, our lack of compassion, our laziness will create chaos in this world. So the question is, how do we challenge chaos on the spiritual level, where it starts, in the heart, those sins, those failures that create chaos? How do we challenge it on that level? Well, the answer is, the God who created the universe and ordered the physical universe and then placed his management into our hands has also provided the spiritual solution to spiritual chaos, and he has placed that solution into our hands, and it comes through the ministry and life, death, and resurrection of the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And let me explain how that happens. Through the life of the Son of God, we receive the example that we need. He walked this earth. He showed us how to show compassion. He showed us how to care for one another. He taught us the truths of the kingdom of God. He taught us how important it is to love God with all our hearts and each other with all our hearts. So through his life, he sets the example. But then through his death on the cross, he takes upon himself the very cause of our chaos, this sin problem that we have, the selfishness that we have, and we're forgiven for that. And then through his resurrection, we're offered a new start, a brand new start. But not only that, through the Holy Spirit, we're offered the power to move forward with this new start in life that God gives us. So Jesus accomplished everything that needed to be done to solve this root chaotic problem, this sin problem that we had. Now, it's interesting what happens at the end of Matthew 28. He gathers his disciples together and he says this. He said, therefore, and this is the solution to solving chaos in the world. He says, therefore, go disciples. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, even to the end of the age. God solves this spiritual chaos in the world through making disciples, through discipleship. And that's important for us to understand. As a church here, our goal is to get the word out, the good news out, that God offers new life through Christ. As we do, people are drawn in here, and they hear that good word. And here, where believers are connected together, they feel secure, and the brokenness in their lives become healed, and they begin growing spiritually, and their lives begin to have impact on other people. So we challenge the spiritual chaos in this world by growing these communities of faith. And this one's been here since 1919, doing that very job. These spiritual communities are strongholds against the chaos in this world. These spiritual communities bring people into a right relationship with their Creator and offer new life. They provide this secure harbor of friendship and fellowship and commitment where broken lives can be mended and made whole. That's why it's important we're here, and that we've been here for many, many years. Through our connected lives, we challenge the chaos, the destruction, and the brokenness caused by sin. And we offer a solution, restoration, and a new start. If we fail, chaos wins. But if we succeed, we bring God's kingdom here, right here, to Coleraine. Amen. Let's turn to our final hymn, number 379, Take My Life.